My name is Josephine Taverna, and I'm an early career investigator in oncology at the University of Texas Health Science Center at San Antonio. I had a unique opportunity to spend 6 months at Eli Lilly in Indianapolis and train with the world experts, scientists, in computer modeling as it relates to early drug development and biomarker discovery. This opportunity was given to me through the NIH National Center for Advancing Translational Science. Once I heard about the program, I immediately applied, and when I was accepted, I made the bold decision to move my family to Indianapolis, and it was the best experience we ever had. I had an opportunity to understand computer modeling as it related to translational science and was able to take preclinical studies and develop a math model that could then be applied to patients in the clinical setting for the purpose of drug development and early phase clinical trial design. What I wanted to do today is to actually share some of the work I did through computer modeling at Eli Lilly. To begin, I started working in the field of Alzheimer's disease, which is something that I've never done before, but learned very quickly about. The research project itself was to develop a quantitative system pharmacology math model describing the synthesis of tau, which becomes aberrant in Alzheimer's disease. It becomes misfolded and then aggregates and spreads from one neuron to another and causes neuronal degeneration, axonal degeneration. The goal was to develop a computer code to simulate the behavior of tau and then to find therapeutic intervention points where you could use one or two drugs to target the disease at the tau protein level, as well as discover new biomarkers of treatment response. So Alzheimer's disease, as you know, is the most common degenerative disease, and it's again characterized by tau protein when it becomes abnormal, misfolded, and aggregates. It leads to progressive dysfunction, irreversible loss of neurons, and neurocognitive decline in patients who develop Alzheimer's disease. It spreads from one neuron to another in a prion-like manner. As you could see here, the tau can be traced using PET imaging studies, and this is a representation of a human brain as it progresses in the disease. So Braak's early staging, as you could tell, has minimal to almost undetectable tau protein, and then it starts coursing through the brain, and you could see now the green and red as the disease advances more, and by Braak stage 5 and 6, the disease has become pretty severe, and patients are very impaired cognitively. Here is a molecular description of tau disease, where you start, normally tau can bind, in its normal state, can bind and unbind to microtubules. It becomes phosphorylated and dephosphorylated. But at some point, it becomes pathologic and develops a tau oligomer, which then misfolds and becomes aggregated, forming paired helical filaments, followed by neurofibrillary tangles, which you can detect by histology as well as PET scan. In this next slide, what you're seeing is in silico mechanistic modeling, the concept. Basically, what we're doing here is you're taking all the in vitro and in vivo animal studies, looking at those kinetic reactions as it relates to tau protein in neurodegeneration, and forming operational differential equations that go into these mathematical models, computer modeling. And you can also take clinical data that was accumulated from early phase clinical studies or late phase clinical studies, and incorporate that again into your mathematical model. So this is known as quantitative system pharmacology, where you could generate mathematical computer models to integrate the biological systems as well as the disease processes for the purpose of finding therapeutic drug intervention points, which then you could test or train the model to see if your drug or combination of drugs will work, and in this case, perhaps decrease tau protein levels in the CSF, for example. This really does aid in the design of in vitro and in vivo non-clinical and clinical experiments. And you can then, again, train your model, meaning calibrate and validate your model using clinical studies in human subjects. So as an example, I will show you how we used one particular math model to explore the vulnerabilities of the tau network. And so we're looking at both neuron populations that are normal as well as the abnormal. And the goal is to see what happens once you tilt the balance in favor of the abnormal abnormal dysfunctional neuron with abnormal tau aggregation. So here's what a mathematical model looks like. The arrows represent these kinetic reactions that can go back and forth. And in the first line, you could see tau zero, which is your normal tau. It can bind and unbind. Microtubules become phosphorylated and dephosphorylated. But once it misfolds, as you could see the MF, it's unable to become degraded by proteasomes, and it cannot be recycled. So instead, they aggregate, and then they form these elongated reactions and produces aggregation and neurofibrillary tangles. So this entire math equations are very useful when you integrate it into your quantitative system pharmacology model, because you could test in the lab your what happens, and then the QSP model will then go from a single neuron describing what happens inside to a multi-scale model, where you can actually now see how neurons progress from one neuron to another through the brain. And so you develop these macrospatial scales that occur over years to decades to describe the global development of Alzheimer's disease in a virtual patient, which incorporates both your Braak staging, your PET imaging, as well as the clinical findings. So the future of CNS drug discovery, research, and development really becomes now computer modeling. And here's a nice representation of the brain as it relates to a computer math model. The ventricles are represented. Each dot can pretty much represent a neuron. And within the neuron is your abnormal aggregation of tau protein. And then you could see how it moves, courses through the brain. You can then use the math model, again, to correlate your PET scan findings in real time, and then find how you can also incorporate the neurocognitive assessments. The clinical pathology can go into this math model, and then you can measure biomarkers based on animal studies, which can correlate well to human studies, and even incorporate proteomics, genomics. And once you have that all together, you can start to design a very effective biomarker-driven phase one clinical trial and enroll your patients safely into those studies. So this is the future and how QSP modeling works in the grand scale. So you have your network biology model represented in the center there. You can apply drug X or apply drug Y or a combination of both, and you can measure your biomarkers. Once you put it into the system, the computer then calculates out the disease activity based on neurocognitive decline or PET scan findings, and can also show you the increased levels or decreased levels of your biomarker. The goal is then to find in your virtual patients which populations will most likely respond versus non-respond to your drug or combination of drugs. So these are valuable lessons that I learned at Eli Lilly and would do over and over again, because the experience was remarkable. I quickly assimilated with a team of scientists in the field of pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics. I made this incredible network network collaborations, which became an integral part of my success as a clinical investigator. I was able to use a lot of this computer modeling to drive my own research in oncology forward. And I've learned to use a multidisciplinary team consisting of computational biologists, chemical engineers, pharmacists, biostatisticians, genomic or proteomics specialists, as well as other phase one, two clinicians across academic institutions. These experiences really have emboldened me to really continue on my search for biomarker drug discovery and drug development. And so these models, again, can help you develop robust hypotheses to drive your research and allow more efficient ways to test novel therapeutics and design effective clinical trials with a biomarker-driven rationale. Furthermore, the computer modeling has given me new ideas for a submission for an R01 grant because of all the new experiences I had and training. I do envision a career in the future after my academic career where I will go either to the Food and Drug Administration, work there, or work at a pharmaceutical company like Eli Lilly. So growth opportunities for a NCATS Lilly scholar would be career mentoring. I had an incredible mentor. His name was Brian Willis, and he mentored me throughout the 6 months. I became incorporated into a team of fantastic scientists who are experts in computer modeling and drug development. And those are collaborations that I will always have moving forward, even after leaving Lilly. I also had an opportunity to go to the NIH in Bethesda, Maryland, and present my work to the National Center for Advancing Translational Science directors, Drs. Christopher Austin and Michael Carrilla. These are, I mentioned before, network opportunities at Lilly. We called them coffee zone meetings, where you actually get to meet with different scientists over a cup of coffee, discuss your passions, your reasons of, you know, your current research and your future directions, and develop collaborations in that way. You get to attend conferences. I went to the University of Indiana, and at this conference, I got to attend a Clinical and Translational Science Institute symposium on disease and therapeutic response modeling and simulation. I got to hear Dr. Julie Stone at Merck, who is the vice president of pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics, and she discussed her mechanistic modeling of the amyloid pathway in Alzheimer's disease, which parallels to the research that I was doing at Lilly. I also had an opportunity to listen to hear a talk by Dr. Jiang Liu, who's a lead pharmacometrician at the Food and Drug Administration, and he gave an incredible talk about how pharmacokinetic, pharmacodynamic, and computer modeling can be applied to research at the FDA. In conclusion, I think that computer modeling is the future, and we're using these models to understand how disease occurs in the virtual patient and how we can translate that from preclinical studies through to the patient's bedside and develop really novel approaches to early phase clinical drug discovery as well as biomarker discovery. So I'd like to thank you and all my listeners, and also to acknowledge very important people who were integral part of my success at Lilly. At the NIH, National Center for Advancing Translational Science, Division of Clinical Innovation, Dr. Christopher Austin, standing to the left, who is the NCATS director, Dr. Michael Carrilla, Director of Division of Clinical Innovation, standing to the right, Dr. Joan Nagel, Program Director within the Division of Clinical Innovation, and Petra Kaufman, who is the former director, as well as Dr. Denise Subramanian, who's the Senior Director of Global Regulatory Affairs. I'd also like to thank my Lilly mentoring team, who were an integral part of my success. In the center, Dr. Brian Willis, who was the principal research scientist of pharmacokinetic pharmacodynamic program within the neurodegenerative group. Dr. Evan Wang, standing to the left, who is the senior research scientist in pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics, and a computer modeler. Dr. Nieves Velez de Mendez Abal from Spain, standing to the left, who was also a computer modeler, Dr. Mensuo Hayashi, standing to the right from Japan, who was a senior research advisor within molecular pathology. I'd also like to thank the entire pharmacodynamic pharmacometrics team at Eli Lilly. And with that, I'd like to thank you for your time and encourage you to visit the NIH website to learn more about this prestigious program.